sun is racing.
Welcome, race fans, to another episode of the Rubbin' is Racing Daily Fantasy NASCAR Show. This week, we have all your action from Loudoun, New Hampshire for the Foxwoods Resort 301. Stages will be at lap 75, lap 150, then they'll race the final 151 laps all the way to the finish. The weather should be partly cloudy and 90 degrees with a 15% chance of thunderstorms for that swampy New England afternoon when we're scheduled to go racing at 3 p.m. Eastern on NBC Sports Network. As you guys can tell, and if you were following on Twitter, I am a co-host down this week. Lear's had an emergency family situation pop up. I've told him to do what he can to deal with his family and that the show will be here waiting for him when he gets back. So just keep Lear's family in your thoughts and prayers. And with that said, let's get into the fantasy goodness this weekend. I think there's a couple of fantasy questions that every player has to ask themselves this weekend. The first is whether or not to rowdy or not to rowdy. Kyle Busch is $11,900, and what he does for your salary is absolutely brutal. But we know JGR dominates at Loudoun, and Rowdy is arguably the best driver here. And we saw a JGR car dominate the Xfinity race. He was second and third in 10 and 15 lap averages, so he's got the right speed and is the right place on the chart, although we'd like to see him at the top. I'm personally rowdying this weekend, and I think a lot of people will default to that, especially after the dominance that we saw from JGR in the Xfinity series. If you don't want to rowdy it, you're probably going to Truex it, who also has the top stats here. Basically tied with Rowdy as being the best driver here. He starts sixth. He's also $11,500. I know your gut says you want to pair the two of these guys together, but at those price tags, it becomes almost impossible to put a comprehensive lineup together when you do that. But if you're not going that route, you're probably going to ask yourself the next important question, which I had to ask even rostering Rowdy. So that question is, do you Harvick or do you not Harvick? As Harvick is starting 14th, he's also another one of the premier drivers at this track. I repeat, Harvick is starting 14th. That's the sweet spot for a stud to get us place differential and still be able to lead some laps if he gets up there and does his job. I think it's very possible that he does both. He also went 14 to first last year in this race. From that exact same starting position, the only problem is he's $11,100. And it's an opportunity cost to play a guy like Harvick versus a lot of these other plays that we'll talk about here in a second. The next question you have to ask yourself is, do I feel like fading or playing Team Penske this week? Keselowski is sitting on the pole and has shown some decent speed. However, his teammate Blaney is the racer that is literally the top of the charts for the 5-lap, 10-lap, and the 15-lap average chart. Now, we've seen Ryan Blaney be the top of the charts before and crap all over himself and be a terrible play. Is that another one of these weekends, or is this the weekend Blaney finally slides out of the funk and joins his Team Penske teammates in collecting a win and making the playoffs? The other option you have, and he's kind of in that sweet spot, he just hasn't shown any speed this week, is that of Joey Logano starting 8th. All of these Penske plays are options for you this weekend, and I couldn't fault anyone that decided to go with any of those guys as a staple in their lineup or even a couple of them. The only other play, in my opinion, that comes out of this top grouping of guys, probably the top 10 drivers or so, is Kurt Busch starting 3rd. The problem with the Kurt Busch play starting 3rd is, and his salary is, he literally has to dominate and rack you up dominator points in order for him to pay off. Just going 3rd to 3rd, I don't believe will produce enough fantasy points for him to pay off this weekend. I also think that he'll probably be overowned in the sense that as Kurt Busch won last weekend and almost won the week before that, people are going to be on the Kurt Busch bandwagon, and I think a lot of people don't run the math and don't realize that starting 3rd, he just can't produce enough points to pay off unless something weird happens. Now that we've got the top group of drivers out of the way, this is where things really get interesting and why the salary gets tight in a hurry, because there's all sorts of cars that give you place differential goodness that you need to be looking at. The first of which is Alex Bowman starting dead last. He's $8,800. Now, starting dead last. There's nowhere for him to go but up. I keep hearing other people talk about fading Alex Bowman because he's going to be so high owned. And their argument here is that if he reaches the 20th position, he'll score points for like a third place racer. And there are other people that can get you those points. That's the argument for why you have to play Alex Bowman, right? 20th is below, well below his average finishing place. So to assume that he's going to get a total of third place points with a finish worse than what he's finished this season is hilarious to me. It is also hilarious to me that people are assuming that these other drivers are going to somehow get up front and dominate, and that somehow is going to outpoint Alex Bowman. I think people are just trying to get too cute for their own good here, and he's $8,800. You want to jump off because of the price, but at the same time, guys, he's going to put up massive points unless something crazy happens. And I would argue to fade him on this chance that something crazy happens if I didn't believe that almost half the field, if not more, are going to try to fade him at something crazy happening, and the percentages of something crazy happening aren't 50%, which is where I think he's actually going to be owned. He should be 85 to 90% owned mathematically. He will probably be sub 50% owned with what I've seen people talking about. And that's just a juicy spot for you to gain because there's very little scenarios where he doesn't show up on the winning lineup. The next guy that you have the same problem with is Denny Hamlin starting 23rd. He's also sent to the rear as they've had to swap out to a backup car. I love Denny Hamlin. He's one of the top graded out drivers on this track, but he's 9K. That's another one of these guys that tightens the belt on your salary and doesn't allow you to do a whole lot. I personally love the Denny Hamlin play. Another play that I like that's just a little bit of a pivot from Hamlin is Billy Byron. He's starting 22nd. His car is also to the rear as he thrashed out his prize. Newman is starting 26th. Another great play in my opinion. He's also to the rear for thrashing out his car in practice. And the car that I don't think anyone has talked about, and it's because I don't know why people are overlooking him, is Kyle Larson, who was actually 2nd on the 15-lap average charts. He's to the rear as well. He starts 15th. Now remember, all these guys that went to the rear don't actually accrue you fantasy points in the positive till they get back to their original starting position. I don't think that's going to be a problem for Byron, Newman, Larson, or Hamlin. I think they all just get there quickly. The problem is trying to figure out how to play these guys with salary. The other guys that didn't wreck their car out and aren't starting from the rear of the field that are really interesting place differential plays, in my opinion, that no one is talking about is Chase Elliott starting 12th. We've seen that be the sweet spot for Chase Elliott and being on a winning lineup. You have Clint Bowyer starting 16th, another juicy spot, and Austin Dillon starting 21st. I would play if I had seen any speed out of his team all weekend, but they haven't really shown the speed. That's what bothers me about it, but man, even him starting 21st is fairly a juicy play here. Guys, those are the plays. After you get past those guys, it is take a guess on which car you want to play for value. And let me explain why it's take a guess. When you get down to the value territory, they've all either overqualified, meaning qualifying starting position is right where their ceiling is for them to finish, or they're in the worst equipment on the circuit. And you have to decide, do I risk going negative with this guy who finishes below his starting position in most instances, or do I have to play one of these cars that I'm going to beg to rack up laps by dragging its ass around the track, hoping that it doesn't have a technical malfunction or that they start and park it, which is also a probability. I hate this bottom tier this week, and you're forced into it with salary from playing these good guys. I mean, if you want to get unique, kids, you can always play some of the guys I haven't talked about. But usually if I'm not talking about them, they have a harder problem getting to where you need them to be mathematically to pay off. Hopefully you guys will have Lear back next week. I think I gave you a quicker rundown as I could and a thorough rundown as I could. I wanted to get this out to you guys quickly. I was going to film it last night, but right when I started getting ready to film, we had a major thunderstorm roll in with lightning and all kinds of craziness, so I decided to wait till this morning, and the storms just wrapped up about an hour ago, so I wanted to make sure I got this information out to you guys. You know, we try to do our best in getting a show out every week that actually has the content that you need. So remember, guys, to like, share, subscribe. Thanks for tuning in. If you want to support the show, you know you can do so on PayPal at Rubbin' Is Racing DFS. Thanks again, guys. Let's win some money this weekend. Keep Lear's family in your thoughts and prayers. And let's take down some money. Hopefully it's me, but if it's not me, I really hope it's one of you guys. Later, y'all.